Now the Carnival of Animals and a famous composer who felt he was celebrated for the wrong thing. Camille Saint-Saëns would have celebrated his 181st birthday this past weekend. Once again, pianist Rob Kapilow joins Jeffrey Brown to explore what makes great music.
Rob Kapilow, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
So today we're marking the birthday of Camille Saint-Saëns. This is a story of a great composer who didn't quite get the legacy that he wanted.
During his lifetime, I mean, he was a famous composer, one of the most famous composers in the world, writing serious operas, serious symphonies.
Tell us a little bit about him, for those who don't
know. He was also one of the world's greatest musical prodigies. In fact, many people think he was even more of a prodigy than Mozart or Mendelssohn. I mean, he started piano at 2.5. Mm-hmm. He wrote his first piece at 4.5, made a public debut at 10, in which not only did he play 2 concertos and write his own cadenza, but for an encore, he offered to play any Beethoven sonata from memory that the audience wanted. That's 32 sonatas at the age of 10. One of the great musical prodigies, utterly famous, yet then for a joke, he writes this piece that literally became his legacy.
So Carnival of the Animals, written for a friend, becomes this famous piece. Tell us about it.
Yeah, it was a little party piece, and in it he took 14 animals in this grand zoological fantasy, is what he called it. And each movement turns an animal somehow into music. Mm-hmm. Now, the simplest way is to take the sound of the actual animal, and in the first movement, that's what happens. A lion's roar is turned into music. But sometimes, for example, in hemiones, which is a wild Tibetan donkey, famous for running at blinding speed up and down rough mountains, he turns the idea of the animal into music and turns that into 2 pianists running up and down the keyboard at blinding speed in unison.
He also has this movement called the Pianists.
Yeah.
And pianists, this is sort of a joke. Pianists
it's just a
as
joke.
An animal.
I mean, it's like based on the scale. It's based on these ridiculous scales that pianists do. Maybe that's the animal that annoys the neighbors when the pianists are actually playing.
Pianists as animals in this
pianists
game.
As animals. Anybody can be a joke, right?
One movement, the Swan, next to last movement, did become hugely, maybe the most famous part of this, right?
It became the most famous piece he ever wrote. And it's interesting, it's the only movement that he actually allowed to be published during his lifetime.
I visited with Yo-Yo Ma last year for a piece for the NewsHour, and he played the Swan for us. So what makes the Swan work so well?
Well, I think writing the piece so quickly gave him access to one of the most beautiful, simple melodies he ever wrote. I mean, it starts off with nothing but the 2 pianos being the rippling waters. And a little crest of a wave. Then everything focuses on the cello. There are only 3 ideas. A swan's neck dips. The same idea lower. Then the swan's neck rises gracefully on a long note. And then a simple scale, but one note makes it great. We stretch it out. Instead of this, we get this beautiful high note on the cello. We go on a journey with this. We come back, we repeat the whole thing a second time, and there's a beautiful epilogue at the end telling us the message. Then for the first time, all of a sudden, the rippling waters stop. We know something important is being shared with us now. We journey with the piece's 3 ideas, and we finish with a simple scale. Stretched out like this. The rippling waters stop. We've been wanting to resolve not up here, but down here, and for the first time, we resolve the piece on a single cello note without accompaniment. The accompaniment's always been in the middle register, not noticeable at all. Now, after this resolution in the cello, suddenly from the heavens, up here, in a brand new register, the pianos take over, those rippling waters become the topic. And we finish with one last wave.
So the swan is the only part that he did allow to be published, but the rest of it,
he wanted it to go away.
He
wanted it to go away. He said it could be published after he died, but he was really worried. Legacy was an important issue, and he was a serious French composer, and that was not what he wanted to be known for. But somehow what snuck into this piece was the most exquisite, pure, simple, beautiful melody that he ever wrote, the swan.
Rob Kapilow, thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Jeff.